Okay, so I've got the iPad set up there and you can pretend it's another person. Hello everyone. And thanks very much for coming back. Welcome back. Day two. And I'm so impressed, and I think everybody when you came in looking at the paintings from yesterday, it's so lovely, isn't it, to see that beautiful colour. And there's a kind of a freshness when you look at it after a night's sleep. I think everybody's work looks incredible. So here we go again. So we've swapped over the still lifes now. So you've got the orange pot down there, and we had Laurie's inspired turquoise tabletop today. So that's a really nice thing with the orange. And then we're working from the jug here with the pink, so the more kind of pastel shades here. Well, in the bottom half anyway, because it's still an explosion of colour in the flowers. Okay, so so that's it. I'm going to start out in a similar way as I did yesterday. Now, we have just a couple of the smaller sheets of paper left, and so I found some bigger sheets yesterday. That's why this sheet is a bit bigger, and there's some on the table there if anyone wanted to use one of those. Okay, so let's see. So the same as yesterday. I think what we'll do is I'll work until 11, so 25 minutes, because I think yesterday went on quite a while. Okay. All right, so to begin with, sometimes people like to put a background colour in, and it might be no harm if you felt like you wanted to paint something in the background, like a Payne's grey, that we used yesterday. But I'm not going to do that now, at this stage. I think I'm quite happy starting on the white paper. And what I'm going to do, because I know there's a pattern on the other side of the jug, I think what I do is I put down something to describe the pattern. Do you know what I'm going to do is take this out, because it's looking straight at me, this that thing. Is that okay?
Oh, no, that's just copy that.
Well, I was going to be the foundation of your painting.
You know, I'm going to plan that. I'm going to
be back in.
I'll
just start the video again. I never adjust anything. Okay. But no, seriously, we might actually put it back in, because it could be a nice extension on that side. Anyway, it's really good. Okay, so let's
see.
Yeah, so I think I'll just, I had torn that yesterday when I was talking about using collage for the dogs and things. I had torn that shape. I was saying you could maybe do something like that on there. I think I'll do that. I decided that on that this morning, so I just put on some blue and a piece of paper here on the table. And my idea, when I saw it on the white paper there, I feel like...
Pardon? I said, that's the jug dog.
That's the jug. Sorted. so I thought maybe, when I'm looking at it on the white paper though, I kind of feel like... Now, the reason I'm putting this in the center of the page is because it feels to me like there's already enough of this asymmetrical thing going on with the plant. So there's the foliage and the flowers are dropping down this side and lifting up here, so that's already enough of a disturbance to symmetry. So that's why I've decided to put the jug in the middle. And it's a slightly bigger sheet of paper as well than yesterday, so I kind of feel like I can fill the page with the flowers. Okay. And I thought as I put it down that maybe I would put a... no. I was going to say I put some white over it. Just to subdue the colour a little bit. To subdue the pattern a little bit. I thought I might put a little bit of white paint over it. Okay, so half closing my eyes again. Just so it's not showing too loudly there. And now on to the green. So the same as yesterday, I'd recommend working with the ultramarine blue. And the hooker's green was they were the two colours I put together to explain the shadows, to explain the general area of the leaves. And it's kind of doing something like going that way, isn't it? The leaves do. You wouldn't want to get white, like when you use white early on, you wouldn't want to get it mixed up with your other colours, really. So that looks to me to be fine. Okay. So I'm going to go with now the the leaves that are coming down here. I've got a touch more of that yellow. There's a little bit of cadmium yellow that looks like that. Do you know that yellow? A little bit of that yellow there. I'm standing right in front of the picture. Okay, there's a little bit of yellow that I can make the green a little less cold there. I'm making a little bit more water. This surface is slightly different. This surface is slightly different from yesterday's. And it seems to be drying a little bit quicker, I think. So I'm putting a bit more fluidity into the head. And I kind of like having some runs and things as well. But if you are doing that, you know, do your best not to hit the floor. And it's a really good idea to step back a lot, to really move. Far back.
Is that cloth?
It's a cloth, yeah, as opposed to kitchen paper.
Yeah.
And there's still some over there, I think. But you can use the dirty ones here even if you wanted to use a curtain. So I've made it quite wet now because the paint is drying here. Just kind of finding the character of the leaves as they tumble down there. Enough for the rose. You want to create a surface that's inspiring to work over and to physically move as well as part of it. So just put something down there again. I find this is quite a nice way of getting a bit of order in the midst of chaos, to have something linear, whether it's in the background or in the the tabletop, you know. This is reminding me, remember to take photos of your work as you go through the painting process today. Take pictures of your work as you go. Okay. And Vandy, if it's okay, I can share this, the video that happens if it works out, you know, and share it then to Vandy, you can pass it on. Just as a reminder of our adventure in painting. No, I think the crimson might work. Your glasses, your pictures.
Well, this is actually, Anya, this is the most kind of interesting and crucial thing, to be completely off the wall, in a way, when most people start terribly carefully withdrawing. Do you see what I mean? Yeah. Yours is just the kind of...
And it's actually the moment that makes me come alive most, is the beginning, you know. It's the reason why at home I would do something like that, tearing and sticking, and it kind of makes you feel a bit lively for the day.
Is this how you would normally work? Because some of your work seems quite formal.
Yeah.
You would normally work like this. Yeah.
Do you mean the portraits, or do you mean
the flowers? Is this how you would normally look approach?
Yeah, recently I've been, like, actually probably since lockdown I've been doing more of this.
Really?
Yeah.
I noticed the difference.
Yeah, and before I used to feel like I had to show some sort of technical, I used to feel like the technical side of things was more important in workshops.
Yeah.
And so I would kind of work to explain all the ways of putting the paint on and things. And as I started doing that, I realised there's less life in that than there is in just encouraging people to come with their own energy to the thing. Something like that.
Yeah.
And so I'm giving more credence to that side of it.
I guess
it's more joy in it.
Yeah.
But there was a time when I would sit down, or well, stand still, but be quite measured and careful.
Yeah.
And sometimes this as an underpainting for that is really useful.
Yeah.
Like, it's a great thing to have something loose and free like the wild goose, and then take an hour or two to really... and that has its own meditative quality. Like, it's quite a nice thing to be in the... atmosphere of the flowers and really being attentive to them for a long time is something lovely. I suppose as soon as you bring attention to anything, an artist friend of mine said, the richness of each day depends on our attention to it. And I think the richness of everything, isn't it, kind of, if you come back into the
really being fully with something, and being fully with flowers is lovely. Okay. Now that's going to go on the floor. It's actually going to be wipeable though, I'd say.
Yeah, it could be fine.
Yeah. Just something again for the shape of the fuchsia there, the shape of the fuchsia down here, and it's lovely having the yellow. Thanks, Virginia, for the lovely yellow flower at the top there. That might be a statement to kind of punctuate things to make do something. I thought it was the lemon yellow. I was putting on there. Dark and a light purple, and I think it's a good idea to start with the dark and work up to the light. And they say the dark is like the base of music, it hangs it all together. So that would be why I put the green leaves together there first. So the purple now might work for, let's see what it looks like. Just underneath the verbena to have something dark there. And finding the position of the flowers in relationship to each other. And then there's a little flowery thing. Maybe it's the Japanese anemone out there, which really is a little bit more pink. Okay. So the fuchsia now, I could probably lift off some of that before it gets too dry. At least I want to show that there's a couple of bundles and it's kind of dropping down. Feel a bit like Turner on the mast or something. The sail can your shackles in. Okay. And I suppose it'd be no harm to lift off this and see it and inform me what's happening here. Okay. The still life where I'm looking at it. So I think a good colour there might be the Payne's Grey again, actually. Just to kind of make a little bit more sense of the job, I'm going to use the Payne's Grey mixed with some white. Any questions anyone or anything like that? Any suggestions? No. Okay, so sometimes what you could do as well, actually. So when I'm painting the background up to meet the jug there, I might even just do that. So that I know. So this is the Payne's Grey mixed with white. And I thought, what did I put into that yesterday to make it a bit more warm? Is it the cadmium orange maybe? Because it seems like it needs to be a little bit warmer for the what's going on in the background there. That's maybe a bit better for the colour of the, kind of roughly the colour of the wall behind. I know this is a bit silly, but I'm going to do this as well. Because I want to be able to do freely, to freely do some room there. And putting the masking tape down means that I can reserve what's there before and still have a freedom in the movement. And sometimes you could do a thing, like if you want the runs to go in a different direction, you could always
I just wanted to manage to do about 500 pages of trying to learn and say okay that and let the runs and drips go in a different direction. And then you could walk around and see what other people are up to, have a cup of tea, and come back and be surprised by your work. Kind of want to be surprised by your work. See if you can manage to get this element of freshness and novelty, because that's what our creative brains respond really well to, novelty, newness, freshness. And then you can do something that'll, you know, in response to that, you jump off another platform. So you keep yourself interested. I think that'll be enough. That's fine. Okay, in the same colour. It might be even, I might choose it in oil pastel rather than something pleasing about ripping off that. The other side might be, if I've got oil pastel, it's not unlike that colour. In fact, if I looked hard enough, I'd find one that's the same as it. That one is really good. So I could use that on the other side. Again, bringing in a little bit of variety, maybe. I'll just try it out anyway. So maybe just where the handle is, it's not exactly the colour, but I think it's all right. I'm just, you know, taking it in a new direction, but I do want to bring some of the, I think I might bring in some of the grey stuff.
Just go back here.
So using a non-dominant hand, I want to do something around there, just to say that's the bottom of the jug, without getting too involved. The reason you'd use your non-dominant hand is so that you don't become careful and try and do it all exactly as the thing is. That's an idea anyway. It's kind of, it takes you out of the comfort zone a little bit again. Okay. It's actually this. I think that's a green, is it? Okay. Alright. So the other thing I was going to do here is to still use a little bit of that Payne's grey mix on the right side too. And it's gonna mean that I work over. See these white things dropping down can happen, the fuchsia can happen over the grey. It's a bit more orange than I wanted. Just make some more of the greyish colour. Sometimes do a background first, yeah. Sometimes if it's an old painting that's sitting there or something, I might use that, or sometimes it's really good, it's very inspiring to have something already done. And with these videos that I've been doing in the morning, the night before I sometimes prepare a sheet of paper. It's a bit like the Atomic Habits we were talking about, having it ready to get going, reduce the friction amount between yourself and the thing you want to do more of. So having the paper set up on the easel bit the night before, that's maybe got the colour of a flower or the vase or something from the still life in it. And then you're already halfway there. You've got the vase colour or you've got the flower colour or something. So
we can just do it in a certain area of the paper, we can cover it.
I'll cover the paper usually, yeah. Just because I'm wanting to go to bed and get the job done and not think about
it.
And
then
you'll
bring
just
white back in if you have to.
And
or
then
you need some white anyway.
Then you could use the white oil pastel. It's acrylic usually.
Okay.
So you could use the white oil pastel, or you could use the white paint if there's white to come back in. It's really exciting doing a backlit. Like if the vase is sitting on the windowsill, and there's really lovely lights coming through the flowers, that can be a lovely way to pick out the brightness. But there isn't an awful lot of brightness then. It's just those little shards in between the flowers and around them. So there isn't a need for an awful lot of white really.
Yeah.
But I think when you start with a white piece of paper, it gives you the opportunity to make big, bold moves. If you're having to fill in the whole tabletop, you're going to do big, bold moves and make it happen swiftly. And I think anything that happens kind of swiftly is a good idea. You're not stalling and making... there isn't an awful lot of opportunity for thinking, you know?
Yeah.
Okay. I think I'm going to stop there. In this paper, it's a little bit baggier, but when it dries, it'll be fine. It's heavy enough, I think. So So I think I'll just stop there now, and maybe later on in the day, if you're up for another demonstration, I could do something after lunch and the flowers, or even earlier.
Yeah.
I don't know. Let me know if you want it to happen earlier. Otherwise, I'll just come around and see you individually. Thanks for watching.
I'm interested.